Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Good evening.
Yeah. Okay. So, we'll start with this Wiedemann-Franz law, which is basically a relation between the electrical conductivity and the thermal conductivity. So, let me just recapitulate what we had done earlier. Okay. We had derived or discussed these general linear response relations. And let me just write that. In which we said electric field is dependent linearly on the current and also on other quantities like this. Okay. And then the thermal current is this. Okay, so these are the two relations that we had just written down. We had not derived them, but what we had seen was this relation could be derived if the magnetic field was zero. Okay, so let's again consider the magnetic field equal to zero case, in which case we get relations which are slightly more specific, but they look like this: Q grad T, and the JQ is this. Okay. So here these coefficients are defined as follows. Rho is the resistivity tensor. Okay, these are all tensors, by the way. So the electric field and the current. So normally when we say J equal to sigma E, then E is equal to rho J, right? So these are both tensors and inverses of each other. And Q is the thermopower or the Seebeck coefficient. And pi here is the Peltier coefficient. And describes an effect where you get a current out of a thermal gradient. The kappa here, this is a Greek symbol, kappa, which is the thermal conductivity. Okay. Now, there is a difference here between Q and kappa, okay? Both are effects which are seen as due to temperature gradients, but one is called thermopower and Q is actually a thermoelectric coefficient, okay? Thermoelectric effect, whereas the kappa is actually a thermal effect. So there is a difference between the two. And what one must remember is that J is an electrical current, which is related to charge transport, okay, electrical transport. And the JQ is heat transport. So it's a transport of energy, not of charge, okay, or of spin or any other quantity. It's pure energy, right? So that's the difference between the two. And in this relation, what one can see, in the second relation, what one can see is that if the Peltier coefficient is put to zero, we basically get the Fourier's law. Okay, that is J equal to minus kappa grad T, right? So that Fourier's law basically tells you what is the heat current in the presence of a thermal gradient. And the kappa gives you the thermal conductivity. That is how good does a material conduct heat, okay? But in general, the linear response relation should include the electrical current also, because the charge, when the charge moves, that also carries current, that also carries heat, and that gives you a Peltier coefficient. All right. So these are the relations that we had derived. And now what we are going to do is to write down simple models for the sigma, okay, and the kappa, right, using the free electron theory. And then we will see that there is a universal relation that relates these two, and that is basically the Wiedemann-Franz law. Okay, that is the electrical conductivity and the thermal conductivity. Okay, So let's see how that works out. Okay, so the electrical conductivity sigma, okay, is given in as the following: minus E squared by 4 pi cube integral. So remember, this we had derived from the Boltzmann transport formalism, where we found out the change in the distribution function due to the application of an electric field, and that gave us this expression del F naught by del E. And we had also used many different approximations, including most importantly the relaxation time approximation, right? Okay, so if you can see the screen here, then you will notice that the battery here is showing 35%, okay? And I forgot to bring the charger today. So when this 35% becomes 1, then we will have to stop, okay? Yeah, next time I'll remember to bring this. Okay, so basically you can see that there is a vector, there is a tensor here on the left hand side, and that is coming from the VV. So you notice here that there is no product here. I did not put a vector product or a scalar product or anything like that. This is just telling you that if you take the sigma alpha beta component, that is sigma xy component, for example, you will have to write here a Vx into Vy. Okay, sigma xx will be Vx into Vx, and so on, right? And the tau here is a relaxation time, which depends on the k point, on the k space also. So the tau could be different for states near the Fermi level or states deep below the Fermi level, right? And this is a relaxation time. All right. So, and this minus del F naught by del E is a highly peaked function. And it's highly peaked around the Fermi level. Right? So minus del F naught by del E would actually be delta function, delta of E minus EF at 0 Kelvin. But at any other finite temperature, it has a width of the order of KBT, roughly around 3.5 to 4 KBT. All right. So given this, if I find out the average conductivity, right, in the XX direction, then I can write this as minus E squared by 4 pi Q tau of EF VF squared by 3, okay, and integral del F naught by del E d cube k, okay. And this one can show that this is basically given by n e squared tau of EF by m star, where n is given by 1 by 4 pi cube into 4 by 3 pi kf cube. So this is the Fermi sphere volume, and this is the delta k, including the spin factor, and the Fermi velocity is h cross kf by m star, and m star is the effective mass, right, the band effective mass. So this is a nearly free electron theory, and this 1 by 3 factor is coming in because if I find out Vx squared, then that is just given by 1/3 of Vx squared plus Vy squared plus Vz squared, okay. And this del F by del E is making sure that we are sampling states only close to the Fermi level, which means that all of these will be equal to Vf squared, right? So that is giving me Vf squared by 3, okay? So this putting everything together, we get sigma xx average is n e squared tau ef by m star, right? So that's important to remember. This is the first result. And similarly, you can see that if you evaluate, for example, the Hall conductance or some other tensor component, you might get different values, okay? And but of course, for the Hall conductance, you would have to turn on the magnetic field as well. And here we don't have a magnetic field, okay? All right. So similarly, if I want to find out the thermal current density, okay, the JQ thermal current density, using which I will find out the thermal conductivity. So that is thermal current density is JQ, and that is given by a similar expression as the electrical conductivity, which is this, that d cube k e minus ef vv tau of k del f naught by del t, t is the temperature, and then the thermal gradient. Okay, So this is the general expression for the thermal current density. And again, remember, this is the heat current and not the electrical current, right? So the heat current is being defined or is proportional to the gradient in temperature. And the proportionality constant here is the thermal conductivity, right? So this is, and if I look at just the, JQ in the X direction, then that is just equal to minus kappa. This is again a tensor, okay, times gradient T. And if I have only a gradient in the X direction and I want to look at thermal conductivity in the XX component, then this simplifies to minus kappa XX dT by dx. Okay, so the kappa XX is given by, in the same way as we have done the electrical conductivity calculation, if we perform this calculation, which is dqk e minus ef vx squared of k tau of k del f naught by del t. Okay, and remember, del f naught by del t is the derivative of the equilibrium Fermi-Dirac distribution function with respect to temperature, and that can also be converted to a derivative of the energy, which is again peaked at the Fermi level. So all these this integral turns out to be determined purely by the Fermi level states. Okay, so this will again give us Vf squared by 3 tau of Ef, and an integral which is this E minus Ef times del F naught by del T. And this integral, if you see here, it's actually the integral, the derivative of the internal energy, which is nothing but the specific heat. Okay, so this turns out to be Vf squared by 3 tau of Ef times Cv. Okay, and for free electrons, we had evaluated the specific heat is actually linear in temperature. So this turns out to be pi squared by 3 tau of Ef n times kb squared t by m star. Okay, so this is the kappa xx. So you can see there is a n e squared tau by m star, and the tau here would be a material dependent quantity. That is, what kind of material is it? What is the defect density? What is the kind of phonon density of states? Because that will determine the relaxation time, right? And what are the bands, for example? What is the band structure? That will determine the M star. The N is the electron density, so that will also be material dependent. So the E squared is the only quantity here, which is sort of a universal number. The rest of the quantities are material dependent. Similarly, in the thermal conductivity, if you see pi squared by 3 is universal, tau, N and M star are material dependent quantities. So if we take the ratio of sigma to, or kappa to sigma, right, then the N, tau and M star basically cancel out. Okay, so all the material dependent quantities will cancel out, and we will be left with only universal quantities, which are KB and the Boltzmann constant and the electronic charge, and of course the temperature. Okay, so that is basically the Wiedemann-Franz law. And let me write this once again. So what we got with the Boltzmann transport formalism in the relaxation time framework is this: sigma xx was n e squared tau of Ef by m star, and the thermal conductivity kappa xx turned out to be pi squared by 3 tau of Ef n kb squared t by m star. So this means that if I take the ratio kappa by sigma, then that will give me pi squared by 3 kb by e whole squared times temperature, right? And the Lorentz number is defined as kappa by sigma t, and that is just this, pi squared by 3 kb by e whole squared, right? So this is a beautiful thing. So this is basically the Wiedemann-Franz law, and this is telling you that the ratio of thermal conductivity to the electrical conductivity multiplied by the temperature is a universal number, right? and this was tested on several materials. So this table is given in Ibach and Luth. You can look it up, but let me write it down here. So I'll write here the element, and here is the L0. It's given in units of watt ohm per Kelvin squared. So the element is sodium, and at 0 degrees Celsius, not 0 degree Kelvin, 0 degrees Celsius, sodium was found to have a Lorentz number of 2.10. Silver was found to have 2.31. Then gold, copper, lead, and platinum, they were all found to have 2.35, 2.23, 2.47, and 2.51. Right? So you can see that within some error bar, all these numbers are roughly similar. And these are all reasonably good metals, right? So lead is not a very good metal, but still it's a metal. And platinum, copper, gold, silver, sodium are of course very good metals. So you see within some error bar, this exactly same number. Okay. The Wiedemann-Franz law is, well, yeah.
Sir, does it depend on temperature, because you have written sodium?
I'm sorry?
Does it depend on temperature?
Yes. So what I'm saying is, this was measured actually at 0 degree Celsius.
But if I see the right hand expression, they are all
right.
Universal.
I'm coming to that. Yeah. So the thing is, it turns out that this is valid only for temperatures. Okay. So this is not valid for temperatures which are extremely low compared to the Debye temperature. Okay. So if you go to, for example, temperatures which are say minus 50 degrees Celsius or something, let's say 100 Kelvin, okay, or let's say 10 Kelvin, right? So a 10 Kelvin, you will see serious violations, okay? And I was just coming to that. So when is the Wiedemann-Franz law actually violated, right? So there are several assumptions that have gone into the derivation of the Wiedemann-Franz law. One is the relaxation time approximation. And that has, and what is that approximation? It's basically saying that the tau in the numerator and the tau in the denominator, right? This is in the heat current, and this is in the electrical current. They are the same, right? And that's why they cancelled off, right? So this is telling us that the thermal relaxation time versus the electrical relaxation time are exactly the same, okay? And this is what gets violated if you go to temperatures which are very far from 0 degree Celsius, okay? So so Saptarishi, you are right that if we look at the derivation, then it's only linear in temperature on the right hand side, the kappa by sigma, okay? But the derivation seriously assumes that the relaxation times for both of these processes are exactly the same. Now, what are the process we are talking about? We are saying that let's put an electric field across a sample, okay, and let the system get to its steady state. So there is a heat, there is an electrical current that is flowing, okay, and now you switch off the electrical current suddenly, okay. So how long would the system take in order for the current to die down to zero, okay? And now take the a different situation where you turn on a thermal gradient, let the system get to a steady state, and then suddenly switch off the thermal gradient, okay? And then ask exactly the same question: what would be the time taken for the system to relax to a zero heat current, okay? So in both these cases, if you look at the relaxation processes for each of the two different cases, then you will find that the two different processes relies heavily on the phonon distribution function, okay? Remember, in the relaxation time approximation, we are not specifying what are the different relaxation processes, right? All of that is buried in the tau of k, okay? But the tau of k, and you can derive that, for example, using the Fermi-Golden rule and other kind of thing that we have discussed, right? So the phonon distribution function plays a very, very important role. And what is seen is that because the phonon density is extremely low at low temperatures, it turns out that the thermal relaxation and the electrical current relaxation are widely different, okay? And that is what causes the serious violation of Wiedemann-Franz law. In fact, that is not the only reason. It turns out that if you have strong electron-electron interactions in the system, that can also cause a deviation of a violation of the Wiedemann-Franz law, because remember, we have used the free electron theory in deriving this. Okay, and if the electrons are strongly interacting, then the free electron theory does not work at all. Okay, the electrons do not behave as free electrons. They behave as, you can have sometimes fractionalized excitations. You can have electrons which are very, very close to being magnetic, for example, or electrons which are just about to relax into a magnetic order, right? So at the boundary of magnetism, electrons can behave completely differently than free electrons. So that can also cause violations of Wiedemann-Franz law. And if you just type in Google Scholar violations of Wiedemann-Franz law, you will see several, several examples, okay? But if you find in a certain system that the Wiedemann-Franz law is satisfied in a range of temperatures which is like close to 0 degrees Celsius, then even though that system might itself be very, very complicated, you might have a good approximation of free electrons in that temperature range, okay? So that is the main utility of the Wiedemann-Franz law. That is, you get a nearly free electron approximation, which is which holds good in some temperature range in a material that doesn't look like a simple metal at all. Okay. So Saptarishi, does that address your question?
Yes, sir. I understand.
Okay. Okay. So this is basically the Wiedemann-Franz law, and now we will move on to a different topic, which is quantum transport in nanostructures. So if there are any other questions, I can answer that. Anything else? Oh, by the way, this Lorentz number, as you can see here, L0 is defined as the ratio of kappa xx by sigma xx. However, you can have different Lorentz numbers also. Okay, so suppose you turn on a magnetic field, you could have defined, for example, kappa xx by sigma xy, right? The thermal conductivity in the xx direction by sigma in the xy direction, and so on. So I will just show you one paper. This is a Nature Communications paper in 2015. And what you see here is this. So let me just expand this. Okay. So notice here an LXX by L0 whole squared. Okay. And L0 is this line. Okay. This dashed line is basically L0. Okay. So if you had taken L0 by L0, you would get 1, right? And what is shown here is a serious violation of the Wiedemann-Franz law in a certain material. And what you see here is LXX by L0 whole squared, LXY by L0, and so on. So you can define different Lorentz numbers, okay? And look at the variation as a function of temperature. And what you see is that around this 300 Kelvin or so, there seem to be reaching the L equal to L0. But there could be very serious deviations. And in this particular material, this is actually this material I'll show you. It's a quasi one-dimensional conductor, first of all. And the material is, this is the material. Lithium 0.9, molybdenum 6, oxygen 70. Okay, it has a set of weakly coupled zigzag chains of molybdenum, oxygen, octahedra, right? So it turns out that electron-electron interactions turn out to be the most important reason for the deviations in the Wiedemann-Franz law. Okay, and in fact, the title of the paper itself says gross violation of the Wiedemann-Franz law in a quasi 1D conductor. So there are many different instances, and that tells you that the free electron theory is not really valid in these systems. Okay, right. Okay, so we'll move on to a slightly different topic, which is quantum transport in nanostructures. Okay, so let's first see what is the main difference between a bulk structure and a nanostructure. Okay, so if you remember, we had taken the approximation of a 3D potential well to describe the free electrons, okay, free electron theory. So when we had done free electron theory, we had said that we have a 3D potential well, and by taking either periodic boundary conditions or by taking open boundary conditions, we derived two different wave functions and two different sets of energy levels. So what were those? If we take periodic boundary conditions, then the wave functions turn out to be kx, ky, kz, turn out to be e to the power I k x x, e to the power I k y, e to the power I k z z, and there is some normalization factor. So, but for open boundary conditions, we saw that it was sine k x x, sine k y, sine k z z. Okay, but the energy expression was similar. Here we got 1 by 2 m. Let me just see, h cross squared by 2 m. kx squared plus ky squared plus kz squared, and this expression was the same in both cases. Okay, but what was interesting was in the periodic boundary condition case, we got a Fermi sphere which defines the highest occupied level, but here we got only the first octant of the Fermi sphere. So why is that? Because here we had the condition that kx, ky, kz are all greater than or equal to zero. Okay, and open boundary conditions means that psi of x, y, z equal to zero, which is the origin, is zero, and also psi of LLL or LX, LY, LZ. Right. So if I go in the x direction and reach LX, the boundary of the system, then the wave function should be zero, or if the in the y direction and in the z direction, right? So this is open boundary conditions, whereas in the periodic boundary conditions, if I go to LX, LY, LZ in any direction, I should come back to x is equal to zero. Okay, so the fundamental difference here is, as you can see, in the wave functions and also in the shape of the Fermi surface. Here it's just an octant, whereas here it was a full Fermi sphere. Okay. Now, when we consider bulk systems, I said that the boundary conditions do not really matter. Okay, boundary conditions do not matter for bulk systems. But will that be true for nanostructures also? Okay, and the answer is no. For nanostructures, boundary conditions are very important. Okay. Boundary conditions are important. But first of all, let's first discuss what exactly are nanostructures. Okay, and we can define nanostructure as any structure which has at least one dimension in the nanoscale. Okay, so at least one dimension of the order of nanometers. Okay, so for example, you could have a zero dimensional system, a quantum dot, okay, which has a radius of the order of nanometer. So in all three dimensions, you have a quantum confinement in the nanometer dimensions. You could have a 1D system, one dimensional, right? So it could be, for example, a nanotube. Okay, and here the radius, the cross-sectional radius, is of the order of nanometers, but the length itself could be of the order of microns. Okay, so now you can see here that there is quantum confinement in two dimensions, right? One of the dimensions is still free, right? You have a macroscopic length there, but in the other two dimensions, you have quantum confinement. You can also have a two-dimensional system. For example, you can have a sheet, okay? So in the sheet, the thickness is of the order of nanometers. So you could have, for example, a monolayer, right, a graphene layer, for example, and the lateral dimensions, the LX, LY, could be of the order of microns or greater than microns, right? So in this case also, you have quantum confinement only in the transverse direction, but free movement in the XY direction. So this is what happens, for example, in a MOSFET, which is where we see the quantum Hall effect. Okay, so nanostructures could be any one of these. And in quantum transport in nanostructures, what we will do is we will consider, first of all, 1D structures. Okay, so in the 1D structure, something like this, the aspect ratio of the system is very, very large, right? So if I consider the length to the diameter ratio, then that has to be of the order of say at least 100 to 1000. Okay, so it's very, very large. So the length is much larger compared to the diameter of the system, right? So that's how we will, and the D itself has to be of the order of nanometer. Okay, so until this point, is everything clear? Because this discussion is going to be crucial in what we do next, especially the open boundary conditions, because in the nanostructure, since one of the dimensions or two of the dimensions are extremely small, we cannot consider periodic boundary conditions. We will have to consider open boundary conditions in those dimensions. Okay, in the dimension where the let's say in the z direction, for example, if the length of the system is very, very large, then the boundary conditions do not matter, and we can take either periodic boundary conditions or open boundary conditions. However, in the directions where quantum confinement is happening, right, which is of the order of nanometer, their open boundary conditions have to be necessarily considered. Okay, and that is going to change things drastically, as we will see. Okay, so if you have any questions, just let me know. Okay, so it has reached, the battery has reached 13. Let's see. Okay, so we, as I said, we will have to consider open boundary conditions for nanostructures. And what this means is that if I write the wave function psi of r, which is 2 by l to the power 3 half sine kx x, sine ky y, and sine kz z. Okay, then kx is given by pi. So this l is an lx ly lz average, okay, 1/3 pi nx by lx. Ky is pi ny by ly, and kz is pi nz by lz. Okay, so notice now what is going to happen, that the delta kx, let's say kx, I take it as pi into 1 by lx, then pi into 2 by lx, and 3 pi by lx, and so on. So the difference between the consecutive kx values is going to be pi by lx. Similarly, the delta ky is going to be pi by ly, and delta kz is pi by lz. Okay, and let's now consider a 1D system where this is, let's say, the z direction, and the x and y directions are this. So this is x, this is y, and this is z, right? So what one can see is that the delta kx and delta ky are going to be much larger than delta kz, because the lx and ly are much smaller compared to the lz. Okay, so the delta kx and delta ky are going to be very large compared to delta kz, and the kx and ky are going to be discrete if the lx and ly are of the order of nanometers. Okay, whereas if lz is of the order of microns to millimeters, then the kz is going to be almost continuous. So what we are seeing here is that the energy spectrum becomes discrete in the direction where there is quantum confinement. But in the direction where there is no quantum confinement, where the electrons are moving freely as waves, there is no confinement, and in that direction, the electronic spectrum is continuous. Okay, so this is a very, very important point, and this will actually crucial to understanding quantum transport in nanostructures. So the point I'm trying to make is that because of quantum confinement in a certain direction, the energy spectrum becomes discrete, okay, in that direction. Whereas in the direction where there is no quantum confinement, the spectrum is still continuous. So going back to free electron theory, all lx, ly, lz were large, okay, of the order of, you know, macroscopic dimensions. In that case, kx, ky, kz, all of them were continuous, okay. And if you have continuum in every direction, then you get then you can define density of states in the usual way, and so on. But here you can see that the electronic spectrum is also behaving in a one-dimensional way, because there is quantum confinement in two different directions, in the x and y directions. Okay, So what that does is that if I write down the energy eigenvalue, okay, so the energy eigenvalue is basically given by h cross squared by 2m kx squared plus ky squared plus kz squared, then you can see that these values are discrete, okay, whereas this is continuous. So what that does is that for every particular kx and ky, you would have a certain parabola. Okay, so it's like saying that E is some E1 plus kz squared, h cross squared kz squared by 2m, where kz is a continuous variable. Then you can have an E2 plus h cross squared kz squared by 2m. Then E3 and so on. Okay, where what is E1? E1 is the lowest value of kx and ky. Then E2 is the slightly higher value of kx and the same value of ky and so on. Okay. Any question?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Can you explain one more time why this spectrum is discrete for kx and ky?
Yeah, sure. So what I'm trying to say here is that if the lx and ly, if the dimensions along the x and y directions are much smaller compared to the lz direction, right, then what you can see is that the delta kx and the delta ky are going to be large as compared to delta kz. You agree with this?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So what would happen is if I write down now the h cross squared kx squared by 2m, then you can see it will have h cross squared by 2m and then pi squared by lx squared times nx squared, right? So the difference between the energies is going to be large because the pi by lx is large. Okay, so whereas in the z direction, because the lz is large, 1 by lz is small, and the difference in the consecutive momentum values along the z direction is going to be very, very small, and hence you still have a continuum in the z direction. Does that make sense?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So in the x and y direction, you have quantum confinement, and that is making the energy levels discrete. Whereas in the z direction, because there is no confinement, you still have the thermodynamic limit and you have a continuum. Okay. And what this will do is that for every given value of E1, you have a parabola. For a given value of E2, you have another parabola, and so on. So you have a sequence of parabolas, okay, corresponding to kx1, ky1, kx2, ky2, kx3, ky3. Okay, so for each particular value of kx and ky, the kz will give you a parabola, right? So there is a sequence of these parabolas, and each of these are called subbands, okay, or channels, channels of transport. Okay, so what is happening, you can see, is that if you take a 3D system and then keep compressing it along two directions and make it into a wire, then that full 3D Fermi surface has broken up into subbands, okay, or channels of transport, and these are all 1D channels of transport, right, because the transport is only happening along the z direction, right, which is where the quantum confinement is absent. Okay, so what I'm trying to show you here is that a full bulk system has broken up into a subbands, okay, and that has given rise to different channels of transport. And now what would happen is if I look at the Fermi sphere in the xy plane, right, and the Fermi sphere has a fixed kf, remember the radius is fixed, right, that is kf, and if the kx and ky are widely spaced, right, then you can see that by decreasing the lx and ly, if I make the carbon nanotube thinner and thinner, right, which means I reduce the diameter, then the lx and ly are going to be smaller and smaller, which means that the delta kx and the delta ky are going to be larger and larger, right? Then fewer and fewer points will fit inside the Fermi sphere. Okay, so I take a different situation where the lx and ly are even smaller, then you will see that only four points are fitting inside the Fermi sphere in the xy plane. Okay, so this is the case where lx and ly are greater than lx and ly in this case. Okay, so by shrinking the carbon nanotube further and further in the diameter, by shrinking the diameter, what we can see is that the number of subbands are decreasing. Okay, and if we take a carbon nanotube which is
extremely, can you just repeat? I could not hear you all.
Yeah, sure.
Do it in next day because charge is very small.
Okay, fine. Yeah, we still have 6%. I can explain to you. Okay, so what I'm trying to say is that if you,
I could hear up to the channel subbands and one dimensional flow and sphere, I could not hear.
Correct. So what I'm saying is that if I take two different nanotubes, one having a diameter of say 2 nanometer and the other one having a diameter of 1 nanometer, then the 2 nanometer has more channels for transport than the 1 nanometer diameter CNT. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, and by this argument, you can see that if I go on decreasing the diameter of the carbon nanotube, I will come to a situation where there is only one channel of transport. Okay. And this has been exploited in quantum transport in nanostructures. And what we'll do next time is that we will see that each channel of transport for in the quantum regime contributes exactly the same conductance, okay? And that is called a universal conductance. It's denoted as G naught, which is given by 2E squared by H, okay? So this is what we will see next time. And there is an author called Supriyo Datta. He has written a book called Quantum Transport, Atoms to Nanostructure or something like that, Atom to Transistor, okay? So what he's trying to describe there is that if you had a nano system like a carbon nanotube sandwiched between two different reservoirs, left and right, okay, and you apply a bias, then what you see is that even though there is no scattering inside the carbon nanotube, it's like ballistic transport. The electrons, once they enter the carbon nanotube, will not scatter at all. Okay, they will just reach the right electrode without any scattering. You might imagine that this will act like a superconductor because there is no scattering at all. It will behave like a perfect conductor. However, you still see that there is a resistance that develops. Okay, and that resistance develops because there are contacts. Okay, and the contacts are the main reason why there is resistance, even though the transport is ballistic inside the 1D conductor. Okay, but surprisingly, doesn't matter what kind of reservoirs you have, the conductance turns out to be universal. Okay, and that is a really surprising thing. And what people have done is that they have steadily decreased the diameter of this 1D system and they have seen steps in the conductance. Okay, and these are universal steps because if you have one channel, you will get 2E squared by H. If you have two channels, you will get 4E squared by H. If you have three channels, you'll get 6E squared by H, right? So you can see that the conductance is jumping by a quantum. Okay, so these are quantum jumps in the conductance and that has been seen. So this is, there is a figure in Ibach and Luth that I'll show you. So here you can see there is a conductance versus time. Now, why is time here? Because what they're doing is they're breaking this is a conventional relay. Apparently they're breaking a contact, okay? And as they're breaking a contact by pulling it, right? It's being pulled at a steady rate. Then the number of channels in that contact is decreasing steadily, okay? And as the number of channels decreases, you see jumps in the conductance, okay? And this is the point at which there is zero channel, this is one channel, two channel, three channels, and so on. Okay, this is beautiful actually. And this is in units of 2E squared by H. It doesn't matter what material you're taking and so on, the jumps are purely universal, okay? Anyway, so let me stop here. I will show you the derivation of this particular conductance in the next class. Okay, sorry, I couldn't take a class tomorrow and yesterday. And tomorrow, of course, there is no exam. Sorry, many of you have asked this question. Tomorrow, there is no exam. And we will have to discuss the exam date. In fact, what I'm thinking is if we can have an offline exam, that would be very nice. Okay, I hate online exams. I suppose all of you guys are coming here by 18th and 19th, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And will you be quarantined?
Yes, sir. For 5 to 7 days.
For 5 to 7 days, right? So maybe by the by the end of January, you guys will all be free, right?
Sir, if someone is infected or become ill, then what will happen?
Okay, fine. They can sit in their room and write. No, you're right. Yeah, that can also happen. We have to take that into account. Let me speak to Dr. Paneerselvam and Professor Vagmare and find out what can be done. Okay. But if it is possible to have it offline, that would be really nice. Okay. But anyway, tomorrow is not the exam, and I will pass on this topics for each of you for the presentation as soon as possible. Okay. Hopefully by today or tomorrow. Okay. So, right, let me stop sharing. Okay.